Hi there, friends. I'll come in here with a quick note to let you know that the first Global Product Owner Summit organized by the Scrum Master Toolbox podcast is coming soon. To know more, check out the bit.ly/productowner2023. That's bit.ly/productowner2023. That's all one word, all lowercase. And stick around to the end of the episode to know more. But for now, on to the show. Hello, everybody. Welcome to a very special bonus episode. In this episode, we have with us Vlad Ukis, who's been on the podcast before, and Philip, and I will pronounce your name probably quite wrongly, Gwendish. Is that how I pronounce your name, Philip?
So it's Gundish.
The Gundish. All right. Gundish. Okay, it's like, yeah, it's the German U.
Exactly.
All right, now I get it. So welcome, guys. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks, Vasco. So great to be here again. Thanks for the invitation.
Glad to be here as well.
So Vlad is a leader of R&D and reliability lead at Siemens Healthineers in Germany. In this capacity, he drives the continuous delivery, SRE, and DevRel, you'll have to explain that for us, transformation, helping this large distributed development organization evolve architecture, deployment, testing, operations, and the culture to implement these new processes at scale. Philip, on the other hand, who also worked at Siemens Healthineers, that's why he's here today, he's now doing, if I remember correctly, you're doing a PhD, right, Philip?
Correct, that's correct.
In Erlangen. So he studied computer science in Erlangen and worked in the operations team at TeamPlay, Siemens Healthineers. And he was responsible for building up and implementing the SRE infrastructure based on tools from Microsoft Azure. Together with Vlad, they drove the mindset transformation, which is something we're going to explore a lot, but of course also the technical aspects, as Philip worked on the technical aspects of enabling the development teams. And Philip is now, as we just said, on his PhD degree in Erlangen. So it was a big project, I gather, this adoption of introduction and adoption of SRE culture and practices at Siemens Healthineers. So let's start from the beginning, guys. Why did Siemens Healthineers decide to engage you and the teams, of course, the whole organization, in the adoption of SRE? What were kind of the biggest problems they were trying to solve with the adoption of site reliability engineering?
Let me take that one and let me tell you a story. So we built up the Siemens Healthineers TeamPlay Digital Health platform, which consists of very many services running in different production data centers. And we started getting more and more users on the platform. And with getting more and more users, we also then saw that, of course, the availability requirements for the platform were growing. So we needed to be more available. And also, if something happened in production, then we needed to reinstate the production in shorter and shorter timeframes in order to reduce the downtime. And back then, our operations capabilities didn't enable us to do so. So basically, we weren't able to provide the platform with the necessary uptime, with the necessary availability. And also, we weren't able to provide the necessary short time to recovery from failures in production. So these were the biggest problems. So on the one hand, the number of users is growing. On the other hand, your availability is not sufficient for that growth. And yet, on the other hand, you cannot recover fast enough from the failures in production. So this is a situation where we understood that we needed to set up operations differently. So we tried several things before, and they kind of didn't lead to the desired outcome. And we said, okay, so we need to try something else. Of course, we didn't know whether the attempt with SRE would succeed or not, but we were at a point where we understood that something else needs to be attempted to see whether that would work.
And when you think about something else, I'm sure that at the time there were arguments and pros and cons for what to do, right? But Siemens Healthineers eventually ended up on focusing and developing certain practices, processes, and also a culture that, you know, overall in the industry we call site reliability engineering, but other people might call it DevOps and agile end-to-end. Like, there are many names for it, right? So what were like kind of the steps for you to kind of converge on what you actually wanted to do in practice? Because I'm sure, like many other big companies, you guys had to present the proposal, somebody had to review it and approve it and say, yes, here's the money, go and do it, right? So How did you come to that decision?
Yeah, so we have got, as every big organization, a list of big topics that we work on. So we've got a portfolio list of bigger topics going on in the organization. And that list contains business things, and that list contains also technical things. So what we managed to do, we managed to convince enough people to put the SRE introduction onto that list of big technical topics that we want to tackle. And that took, of course, first of all, an understanding of what SRE is, some projection of what SRE might do for team play, and also conviction of several stakeholders that this is worth trying, because it seems to be promising, and this is something that we haven't tried before, and there are enough companies in the industry that seem to be rather successful in the area of digital services operations with that methodology.
So you basically work through first an understanding so that you could present it, and then you work through the networks, like the key stakeholders that were in kind of probably in rough terms maintaining that list of big initiatives, right?
Right.
So when we introduce SRE or any other large change in the way we work, there are, of course, some predictable obstacles. What were some of the most important obstacles that you had to overcome during the introduction and adoption of SRE? Let's start with Philip now.
Yeah, so whenever you want to introduce such a huge new topic, then of course some of the peoples will appreciate it and some others won't. And it's very difficult then to convince those who won't or don't like to do it about the benefits if they are not really that well measurable in the first sight. So that's a huge issue with site reliability engineering, because you cannot predict an outage, otherwise you would prohibit it if you know the root cause. So it's very difficult to actually come up with some calculation about the costs or stopped costs. And that makes it particularly difficult for the teams to understand where the huge benefit is. And therefore it was, I think that's one of the biggest obstacles we faced in the beginning. Another one would be the responsibility question. So once the teams roll out new products, when they develop something for example, for a CT scanner, then that's a period of time where they develop the new software and then it is shipped. And they actually will never take care about the particular code, lines of code again, until a new version is required, until new bug fixes are need to be done. But they will be collected from a totally different team, and then they will be encouraged to do so after a while. So that is completely different to a software online product where you continuously need to adapt and update your lines of code depending on the number of exceptions which are thrown immediately after you have rolled out something. And that then was the question, who should actually do that work? So who should collect all this? And usually then the common sense is to include the operations team to do that. But if you need to respond very, very quickly, and you have lots of different services you have not written the code for, then you are stuck somehow, because it will take a ton of time to get into it. So that's not a feasible approach. And therefore, we need to shift the mindset so the teams understand, yes, the developers, whoever writes the code, needs to also immediately respond to alerts when something is going wrong. So this is another big obstacle. But
I understand correctly that how you described it, or what you described, was that developers were kind of developing features for existing services or devices, and once the feature was out and in production, they just went on to something else and they never came back. They never took care that the code they had produced was still delivering the value that was expected. Is that what you said?
No, that's the common approach if you develop code for a CT scanner or something like that, which is not an online software product. And lots of our developers, of course, had experience in that field and now needed to transfer to this new online approach and software, writing software continuously. And that was a transition, I would say.
Yeah, so it's like transitioning from code and forget to code and operate, right?
Yeah, and it's also like this common word phrase, which is code it, ship it, own it, right? So the own it part was not understood until that point in time, I would say.
I think what we experienced was a transition from a business that's selling on-premise software to a business that's selling subscriptions to online software. And I think any organization where software as a service is a new business model will experience something like that. So all the internal people, they never experienced how an online service needs to be operated. And suddenly they become responsible for operating an online service. And I think this is a huge transition on the one hand at the business level, because you are then recognizing the revenue recurringly instead of just doing dedicated sales, one-time sales. And then that's a change in the organizational processes, how the organization is set up in order to deliver online services much more frequently than the on-premise software. And of course, particularly in the area of operations, how do you operate the services if you've got no experience with something like this?
Yeah, absolutely. And I imagine, because you said it implicitly, I imagine that one of the big obstacles was to kind of put the two aspects together, right? Like the technical aspects that enable this idea of having subscription to a software-based service, and also the business aspect. And sometimes they work at different speeds as well, right? Like maybe sales goes too fast or goes too slow, and you know, software is not in sync. Well, how did that work?
So the transition on the business side was slower than at times than the transition at the technical side. So the transition on the business side was initiated by the customers who were willing together with us as the organization to try out software as a service, because it's a change not just internally to offer software as a service, but also externally in the healthcare domain to start consuming software as a service. Because traditionally, hospitals, which are organizations we sell into, they consume on-premise software. So the majority of the software is not online software. And that was new, that actually now you can have in a software in a hospital department something that's always available and updated frequently and operated by someone else and not the hospital IT department. So they were initial customers where we could make that happen. And together with us, they also transformed themselves internally to be able to consume an online service. Whereas on the internal side, we from the beginning aimed at continuous delivery. So we from the beginning wanted to update the services frequently. And as time goes by, we also realize that we need to actually also operate the services if we go as fast. So I would say, yeah, there's definitely kind of a disconnect there between the business transformation and the technical transformation. So for example, if you go technically more frequently than your sales force can consume, then you need to figure out how to actually say, inform the salespeople and also inform the customers about all those new features that are now actually being produced more frequently than the traditional frequency with which the traditional sales force is capable to work with.
Yeah, that's actually a very good point. I remember way back when in 2000, maybe 2008, I very often got this pushback in at that time agile adoption processes that, you know, customers are not ready to consume that many features that quickly. And one of the things that came to mind at that time as we were discussing, you know, the advantages of adopting agile, and in this case SRE, on the business domain, right? Like, what are the advantages? Because if there aren't any, there's no reason to adopt it, right? And one of the things that came up quite clearly at that time is that even if certain customers, say telcos or banks, can only take software once a year, right? Like, you give them software and they, you know, it's a change process for them and they need to install it, especially if it's on premise and so on, and then they need to train their personnel and so on. Even if there's customers who can only take software once a year, there's new customers coming in every month. So the advantages that software brings are not only for the existing customers, they are also for the prospects, those that haven't yet signed the contract, right? And I'm pretty sure that the salespeople catch on to this idea very quickly because they like to sell the future, right? Salespeople like to say, this is coming, this is coming, this is coming. And the old customers might not be even open to that discussion, while the new ones, the ones that are coming up, might be very open to this. And this gives salespeople a lot of opportunity to go into the customer and say, hey, this is coming next month. If you want to sign with us, you get this immediately. So sign with us, right? How did that conversation go in your case? Like, did you actually have like this change discussions also with salespeople to help them understand how this speed of delivery would help them sell more?
Yeah, definitely. So I think the changing idea here is that if you've got an online service, then say in a year's time, this is not the same online service. This is a service that has changed because we continuously are working on it. And actually, it's kind of changing very frequently. And in our industry, for example, changing the service, say, every month or every 2 weeks is already considered frequently.
So, but Vlad, I imagine that in the process of adoption, there were, you know, different pressures. So I can imagine that, you know, software engineers who didn't want to change, like we talked about the skeptics, right? There's always skeptics in any change process. They may not want to change the way they work, and they kind of like, you know, I don't want this. But then also from the sales side, I imagine there could be two types of pressures, right? The pressure of don't give me any new features. I already have enough trouble selling what we have. And then the different pressure, which was the one I was referring to in my story from 2008, which is this pressure to deliver more, give me more so I can sell more. Like, how did this type of pressures affect your SRE adoption?
Right. I think there were two tides there. So one tide at the beginning was, I want more features to sell. I want you to deliver more features frequently to sell. And that, of course, pushed us more towards implement continuous delivery. And with that, of course, comes also, okay, now you also need to be able to operate it, especially as the number of sales is growing and there are more and more customers on the platform who are demanding more availability and who are demanding shorter time to recovery from incidents. Then the tide also can change. Once you've reached a certain speed of delivery, then it could be okay. From the sales point of view, actually, we now more or less have got enough to do a generic sale, and actually you adding, you know, 20 features more frequently now doesn't really move the dial anymore on my sales. And I actually cannot even as a salesperson educate myself about the new features frequently enough, let alone educate the customer. So it was kind of two waves were there.
So you mean these two waves, but I imagine that it went a little bit like really like a wave, right? Like, so at some points more features were needed, at some other points there were too many features. It was kind of oscillating, right?
I would say once we reached a certain velocity of feature delivery, there was no more pressure from the sales to deliver more frequently.
And when we think about SRE adoption, there's obviously a lot of learning aspects here. Like we just talked about the business impact and how sales also needs to learn to deal with the more quick delivery or more frequent delivery. But there's also the aspect of the team's learning. And I know that Philip has a story about how sometimes the fastest way to deliver something is not the best way to deliver something. Can you tell us that story, Philip?
Yeah, it's actually the shortest path might not be the fastest, right? So we were educating the teams. Now, let's imagine you have you're a software development team who has never heard about SRE. And then you need to operate your product, and you do that somehow, meaning you might have some alerts on critical things which are already broken. Or you don't have any such metrics, and you look into dashboards once a day or something like that. Now, in a software product which is online and needs to run 24/7, that response time is very slow. Until you can get to the root cause, it takes another time, and then once you have identified the root cause, you need to fix it very quickly. So how do you now encourage a team to actually switch over to SRE to see all these benefits? Now, the first thing is you need to convince the team that to give the teams an overview about how good their services actually are. So sometimes they have a completely different understanding, either to the good side or to the bad side of the availability of their current services. So and there is already the key point I want to make. So first, you can, of course, tell them and say, hey, here is the service availability. And that's how it looks like. And if you want to operate your services about your thought targets of 99.9% availability, then you will get completely flooded with availability alerts all the time. That would be one side. So you play the educator and tell them that right away. But it took us some time to understand that you need to leave the team with their thoughts until they can experience what is up with the services on their own. So we actually would then not talk about the actual performance of their services. We just take what they want to have as the targets, and then they get this learning. And we know for sure that after a week has passed, we will have another meeting correcting these targets or correcting the expectations to their services, so they can focus on the very, very bad end.
So are you saying that instead of saying, hey, this is the thing you need to do, you would go to the team and say, okay, if the overall goal is X, what do you want to do? And then you would help them to get to that, right?
Correct. And also to get really this transparency of how is the service performing in the cloud. So how is the latency? How is the availability? These common service level indicators, what the SRE book is written about. So you will show them how they are performing, and then they say, okay, let's put the targets then maybe a little lower, the service level objectives. Let's have different targets. So that is the first learning process, to get the common understanding throughout the team. What is the actual service behavior in the cloud at this very moment, right? So this transparency is already something the teams need to understand. And if you just tell them, hey, yeah, this target you have in mind sounds great, but is not feasible at the moment, then they will not have the learning made of, oh, it's really not feasible at the moment. It's really worse. Our services need to improve to get to that point, right? So if you just tell them, it will not work. So they need to feel somehow the pain to then have more encouragement and want to actually improve on their services. Otherwise, it's just some other work item they need to just check mark, and then they can go on with feature work. But that's not how site reliability engineering should be worked on.
Yeah, I like how you describe it. Help them feel the pain. And that's actually something I learned from my own experiences, that where there is no pain, there is no change, right? And if instead of highlighting and helping teams understand where the pains are, if we try to push them to do something, they might even do it, but they won't do it the way it should be done because they don't understand what they are actually trying to achieve. They only understand the task.
And also, I want to add, don't throw them in the cold water and leave them there. So that's also some point. You, of course, need to then reach out to the team and then show them a helping hand to get out of the cold water really quick, right? So that is then the learning process, how it's the fastest way, to my experience.
Yeah, absolutely. Throw them in cold water, but jump in with them.
Yes.
So I know that you guys also had what I would consider quite kind of a normal process of going to like a central function to help the teams, right? Like that eventually you created a team that would be helping the teams. And I wonder if you guys could tell us a bit more of the story of that team, especially on the technical side, Philip. Like what were the problems you were facing? How did you decide to create that centralized team, and what was that team doing?
Yeah, so actually the first thing when we looked into SRE was all these concepts of SLIs, SLOs, and all of that. So there was a bridge to or knowledge to be transferred to the teams, so everyone knows about these terminologies and knows what they're actually meaning. So that was one part of it, so the knowledge education part. So we needed to have sessions to go team by team and service by service, go through them, and show at each of these indicators, transfer the knowledge, what does that mean, and how does the service level objectives then map to being notified at the given point in time, and then you need to investigate what's the real root cause of that problem. So that was sort of the knowledge transfer we need to achieve. But of course, we also wanted to do that to lift off the work from the teams. So basically,
can you explain that? What do you mean by lift off work from the teams?
Yes. So basically what we have in mind was, let's assume now the teams have understood these knowledge steps. They know what an SLI and SLO is, and they know about their service capabilities. So they know feature X, Y, Z in the UI maps to that endpoint, whatever. And then they can really come up with meaningful targets, which do reflect customer or services behavior. And once they have now these targets in mind, the effort of the teams should be very, very low to actually get the alerts or to actually monitor the service. And there was a gap missing in the Azure infrastructure to actually do that. So we faced teams to implement tons of different solutions to actually come to such alerts. But we wanted to have a comprehensive overview about all services we operate for all the teams in a standardized way. So they would just tell us the SLOs, and we will, the team actually implementing the SRE infrastructure will then map these SLOs to Azure checks and the actually notifying the teams further.
Let's take a concrete example. So that would mean, like, let's say that there are 20 teams developing different things for different services, mm-hmm. and they all need to provide some kind of visibility or observability to certain events, like, for example, when a particular service endpoint is not available, or when the connection to the UI isn't possible, or when the network is down, or when the latency is too high, right? That's what I'm understanding.
Exactly.
And these 20 teams all need to provide the same.
Exactly.
Right. And if I understood you correctly, what you guys did is that you provided some sort of a framework that they could use, but then you also provided the visualization of all of those alerts, right?
Totally right. So we had these two sort of feedback loops. So you have the SLOs, you know what the service should look like, and then you want to get alerted whenever these SLOs are broken, right? So that's the simplest. You want to get these notifications. But the other one is, okay, retrospective. Now we are in the end of our sprint or whatever. Do we have some services which performing not to our standards? Of course, we were called out middle of the night 20 times or something like that. So then they know immediately, but what about the other endpoints? Are they all performing well enough, or is there something approaching which looks like consuming more and more error budget and will in the next version, if you don't do some counterparts to it, then it will possibly break the SLO. So we also wanted to give them this long-term history overview so they can check back, oh, at that point in time where the rollout was, suddenly this and that functionality started to degrade or something like that. So, and therefore we collected all the data and summarized it on a daily basis for service and even endpoint level, and then show that in a comprehensive overview to the teams.
And this was something that you centralized because you realized that everybody needed to do the same, and you can just provide it to all of them at the same time.
Exactly. So the work was only done once, and then, we could scale about over the teams, so they only need to come up with the SLOs. But I will hand over to Vlad, maybe to
very
add some.
Importantly, those dashboards that Philip just mentioned, they were also meant and used by the product owners. because it's about prioritization. So these dashboards that show you that, for example, over the last 3 months, these and these services, they didn't perform according to our expectations, which are the SLOs that were defined together with the product owners, then that's really data-driven input for prioritization by the product owners.
And that's a very important point, because the SRE is not just something that, you know, leads to more frequent delivery. I mean, you could achieve more frequent delivery in any other way. It's about connecting all of the things that lead to decision making, and in this case, the product owner being available or being aware of what are the levels of quality of the service they own, and being able to make decisions on where to invest in order to improve or maintain that quality, right?
Exactly right. Yeah.
So for those of us that are now listening to this episode, and there's also another episode with Vlad, where he explains a lot more about the SRE culture and adoption. So we'll put the link on the show notes for that as well. But for those of us that are maybe convinced that this may be a good fit for us, it could be some CTO or Scrum Master or product owner or developer listening to us right now, what would be your advice regarding where and how they should start to bring the awareness and finally the adoption of SRE to their organizations? Let's start with Vlad.
So I think this is a profoundly different way of operating digital services. Therefore, initial education would be very important. So there are lots of videos by Google, for example, online. I think they've got an entire YouTube channel on SRE. So they would be able to learn what that's about and what the core of the approach is. Then there are the original books written by Google that explain really in depth how Google does SRE. So then we also published a book that tells about how we approached SRE and what we did with the concepts. But I think that initial education would be important, because once you start talking internally about that kind of thing, you need to have your knowledge proficient enough to be able to convince people about this who typically have never done something like this before. And therefore, you need to have all your concepts and ideas and argumentation really ready to be used in conversations with stakeholders who look at operations from different lenses. So you would need to talk to product people about operations, which is going to be new to them. You will need to start talking to the development people about operations, which might actually, in all likelihood, also be new to them if the organization is new to operating digital services. And also importantly, you will need to talk about this to the operations people who actually typically have never enabled others to do operations. So typically the operations people, they do operations themselves. But now you need to turn that around, and you need to, as operations team, you need to create a framework or infrastructure that would enable developers to do operations themselves efficiently and effectively.
Absolutely. How about you, Philip? Like you had a much more technical perspective on the SRE adoption. So for those who are also more familiar and comfortable with the technical aspects, where would you advise that they get started?
So I think from technical perspective, it's most important to get a standardized logging established. So you get some data you can even evaluate then later on. And I think that is a good point to start with as early as possible, because you might have additional iterations on that until you're finalized and you're confident with all the logs coming in. I think that's a good starting point. And then from that on, building further. And maybe what type of logging I'm referring to is these HTTP headers, which can be read out to log the result code of the HTTP requests, and as well the latency. So how long does the request take? These two measurements are already sufficient to come up with availability and latency SLIs. And that's a very good point to start with.
Do you have a resource where people could go and learn more about standardized logging?
Oh, that's a tough question. So actually, I don't have something in my mind at the very moment. I think you will find some literature if you just search for it. And yeah, there are lots of different software products available, which does do that automatically for you. So I don't encourage you to actually write log statements into your code. That's not the correct point to track the HTTP requests. You rather would use an agent to install on a virtual machine or to enable it, something like that. In Azure Cloud, for example, there's Application Insights or Log Analytics, which can be just toggled on, and then you get the sufficient logs there.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can send me a link later on, and I'll add that to the show notes
Sounds good.
for more perspective, like a blog post or a link to the documents to that application you just mentioned.
Sounds
Right,
good.
guys, we're getting close to the end, but before we go, why don't you guys share with us where people can find out more about you and the work that you're doing? Vlad, let's start with you.
Yeah, I'm available on LinkedIn, and there are lots of conversations there on SRE. So looking forward to your listeners joining and continuing the conversation there.
Absolutely. How about you, Philip?
Yeah, same as for me. LinkedIn is a very good point to start a connection with me and a new conversation. I'm happy to answer your questions if you have any, and yeah, just reach out.
Absolutely. Vlad and Philip, thank you very much for your generosity with your time and your knowledge.
Thank
Thanks a
you,
lot.
Austin.
Was a pleasure. Thanks.
Hi there, Agile friends. Thank you for sticking around. This year's first global summit dedicated to the product owner role in Scrum will have some amazing keynotes and two tracks filled with firsthand stories and experiences for product owners to learn more about that critical Scrum role. We'll have Roman Pichler, author and product expert, who'll be answering your questions and sharing the most important aspects of the product owner role. We'll also have Colleen Johnson talking about why roadmaps are probably making your life much harder than it needs to be and what to do instead. This talk was quite a success in Agile Online Summit 2022, and Colleen has learned some new tricks, tools, techniques that she will share with us when it comes to roadmaps for the product owner role. And we will also have Henrik Nyberg, author of Scrum and Kanban from the Trenches, as well as one of the creators of the Spotify model. So come in and listen to his stories. And we'll also have, of course, two tracks with many more sessions and even some live sessions. The two tracks will cover practices every product owner should know, where we'll be hosting conversations on topics that product owners need to be familiar with, like product backlog refinement, planning, and much more. The second track will be on metrics, measuring product and personal success as a product owner. As product owners, it's crucial to have a clear understanding of what are the metrics that drive success for us, and of course also for the products and businesses that we work with, and we need to continuously measure and optimize those metrics. So in this track, we'll be sharing what's working and what's not in the area of measuring success for product owners. We will also have the opportunity to network with our peers. It's a network event, of course, so get your tickets and join our Slack. Go to bit.ly/productowner2023. That's all one word, all lowercase. As always, we will have free tickets and VIP tickets, which will give you long-term access to the content of this summit. So check them out at bit.ly/productowner2023. All lowercase, all one word. I'll see you on the summit floor.